Yes, this is exciting. Very exciting. Portland Spencer? Oh my God, I gotta go on live stream just to be able to talk to you. I don't get to talk to you regularly, but all of a sudden I do a live stream and you sign in. Adam's here. Oh man, this has the makings of a very amazing discussion. Jerry, I was hoping you'd be here, Jerry. I was hoping you'd be here. I had a feeling you'd be here, and now you're here. I'm very excited that you're here. I have some stuff. Marina, yes. Okay. Man, you guys. This is the most human interaction I've had in a long time, so I'm really excited. And you guys are texting me, too, at the same time. Oh, my God, yes. Hawaii's in the house. Jerry, miss you too, buddy. Yes, I'm going to tell everyone that's texting me to chat me on the box. Anthony, look at all these people that I don't get to talk to unless I go on live stream. This is my first time. Adam's been telling me good things about you guys. James is here. Man, all right. Well, I guess, to start, to kick things off, I definitely hope everybody's at home, happy, healthy, warm, safe. And I think that for me, I think it's important to just throw out there that in no way am I claiming to be any kind of expert or guru or, grandmaster, or anything like that. And I think that one of my favorite kind of parts of working at Ineffable is that we pretty much have this type of conversation every day, all the time. And right before we went live, with you guys, we were literally going live with each other, talking about all the same stuff. I didn't necessarily prepare any, specific spiel. Thank you for all the birthday love. I appreciate it. And it was actually David Parnes' birthday as well. And he tried to postpone his birthday. We would not allow him to do that. So happy birthday to you, Parnesy, and all Aries. All Aries birthdays were very special. So I wanted to point out that, again, with some of the stuff that we're doing, particularly this conversation, the biggest takeaway is if you want to be a successful artist or if you want to be a successful music industry professional, you have to acknowledge and admit the fact that really we don't know anything. And you have to consistently be fully obsessed with learning, learning all the time, going on webinars, listening, going in forums, talking to as many people as you possibly can. And again, you might see me get pretty excited just because I love everything about the music business, completely obsessed with it. And usually, again, if I'm not talking to someone at the office, for the last couple of weeks, I've been talking to my parents, my girlfriend, my dog, anyone that will listen, I'm talking to them. So I'm sure they, probably would thank you guys for giving me an outlet to even, talk about all this stuff. So I think, for me, I consider myself one of the luckiest, humans ever, just because my job full time is the music business. Every day I wake up, I'm excited to get to work. I can't wait to get back to the office. And I know, for most of the people that work at Ineffable, we're still able to do a lot of our jobs remotely, just like this, with Zoom and with Google Hangouts and with some of this other stuff. But I just think that the overall ability to continuously have this conversation, and a big part of this conversation for us is just how fast everything changes and how many changes there are within the music business. What those changes are, from social media platforms, different tools, different analytics, all these different strategies and all these different things, that everyone's doing. And a lot of times when we, kind of step back and reverse engineer that conversation, there are very few things that remain the same and that are constant. And one of those things is touring. And I know that, of course, there's been changes within the touring game, a lot of different things, but essentially touring makes up a bulk of the revenue stream for so many artists. And that's why right now it's a pretty scary time in unprecedented time with a complete shutdown worldwide, simultaneously worldwide shutdown of all touring. And I think, you know, there's a real important conversation to be had regarding why we're doing a broadcast like this and what our main objective is. And I think a part of that stems from just seeing, you know, the friends, family members, and just people that we work with so closely in a position of uncomfort and just not knowing what's going to happen. You know, tours that for years have been planned that got canceled, millions of dollars, you know, lost, and things of that nature. And so with this kind of unprecedented, definitely at least in our lifetime, you know, nothing like this has ever happened. But for me and for a lot of us at Ineffable, I think what's important is to utilize this time to make sure that we can go back in and strengthen a lot of our other revenue streams, and really spend the downtime, quote unquote, to make sure that when touring comes back, when things come back to, you know, to normal, and I'm very confident that eventually they will, we're in a position to where we have a little bit more balance, and a little bit more, you know, kind of ability to sustain anything that, you know, that can come our way. And I think that, again, the touring side of things being completely shut down, the highlight and the spotlight on other ways to potentially monetize and other ways to survive this, you know, have become so important. And I think that whether you're an artist or a fan, I guess we're all fans first and foremost, but whether you're an artist or you're a music industry professional or you want to be a music industry professional, the following point is extremely important. And I think, like, you know, I want all of us, all 26 of us to 27, to take this point and continue to help spread it. And that is kind of the following example. So I'll come home when I used to go to work. I'll come home from work and I'll see my girl and she'll be sitting there and she'll be on iTunes and she will be clicking, you know, top banners and buying, clicking and buying, clicking and buying. And I'll be like, whoa, like, babe, what are you doing? You know, like, don't just click and buy, you know, all these songs. And she'll kind of give me like a side eye look and say, well, you of all people, you know, I would think you would want me to, you know, support these artists. And of course I do. But understanding how to support these artists in the best way possible, especially during this time, is really, really simple. It's stream them, because if you buy that one song for 99 cents, and I'm not saying don't buy, I'm saying buy as well. But when you listen, listen via Spotify, via YouTube, via Apple Music, Pandora, listen in a way that you know, that you're actually streaming them, because by doing so, every time you listen to your favorite song, you're helping your favorite artist. And that is the biggest thing that you can do, especially right now, especially since, you know, drive times are kind of down. And that's when I listen to a lot of my music, is when I'm driving. You know, listen to them repeatedly, put them on mute if you have to, and continuously listen to them, because that will most definitely, you know, put them in a better position to where, even if there is touring, even when they're, you know, even when touring comes back, the revenue that comes from streaming, it will balance out the decisions that you need to make and just help you be, you know, financially, you know, stable, a lot more stable than, you know, than the current kind of system that we have. So again, please make sure that everybody understands that streaming is critical. And I know there's somewhat of a misconception between the fact that, you know, that especially when I read forums and when I'm, you know, when I talk to a lot of people, that the payout is so low, it's something like 0.003 cents or something. Adam could probably give you the exact amount per stream. And yes, it is low, but it adds up so much and it adds up so fast that it actually drives, you know, revenue significantly more than any of us could really know. And when I go to sleep, thank you. Yep, that's the amount right there. When I go to sleep, I literally leave, you know, my favorite playlist on, you know, playing in the background and just let it stream through the night. And again, it's only a couple streams that trickle in from that. But from those streams and from the stuff that we're able to do on the streaming side, we're able to be in a position now to where a lot of our artists hopefully can be, you know, comfortable enough to sustain themselves without ever having to go and tour. And I think the next part, and you know, the real part of this, you know, kind of whole conversation is learning and understanding how the game works, so that way you can understand properly how to monetize from your music. So as a fan, again, it's simple enough. All I have to do is just listen, you know, to my favorite artists, listen to them on repeat. And even if I download something offline from Spotify, as soon as I touch the internet again, it still counts, you know, for my favorite artists. But now more than ever, the different ways that you can monetize your catalog and your music, and the different tools that exist to allow you to monetize your music, really level the playing field and make it so, you know, it's definitely more feasible for somebody to be a professional musician, and to be, oh, my dad's calling me, to be a professional musician and actually make a living, and not having to, you know, not have to get a second job, not having to, you know, do kind of these weird, odd things, and not having to just solely rely on, you know, on touring. And I think, like, for me, and again, a lot of us at Ineffable, this time specifically has been spent on understanding what these different methods are, from your publishing to your sound exchange, and of course your sales and your streams, to make sure that, you know, we're doing everything we can to, on our end, collect for our clients, but also to make sure that, you know, all independent artists know and understand that the music business is so multifaceted, and there's so many ways to actually really monetize and actually make enough money to where you're living comfortably just by continuously, you know, creating. And that's a great, like, question in terms of which platform do I prefer, which platform is better. Each platform has its advantages and its disadvantages. And until one of the platforms decides to step forward and, you know, and sponsor us and or, you know, work with us in a closer way, we don't necessarily promote one platform over the other, because people already have their preferences. And it's important as an artist to make your music available on all platforms. And by doing so, you're not forcing somebody to go to Pandora. If I don't have Pandora, I'm not sure how to sign up or whatever. I might have lost that listener right then and there. But if I'm making my music available everywhere, then it's up to you as the listener to choose where you want to listen. And I'm seeing, for example, someone that has Amazon Prime, you know, they might not realize that they already have access to probably every song that ever existed, you know, at their fingertips, and they've already paid for that. So it doesn't cost them anything extra, you know, to go in and listen to your music. Personally, I love Spotify. I love Apple Music. I love YouTube. And, you know, just because of my kind of my, you know, what I do for a living, I've had a good chance to dive into a lot of the different platforms and see which ones work better. And by doing so, again, I have my personal preferences, but I've also seen that there's just diehard people that live on YouTube. There's people that are only listening and waiting every Friday for, you know, your release radar on Spotify to discover music. And I think that going back to, you know, which platform is best, it's important to acknowledge the fact that the way that people listen to music has significantly changed. And the biggest driving factor kind of towards, you know, what you're going to listen to is more so your mood than anything else, right? So if I'm going to the gym, you know, I'm going to turn on my gym playlist, and my gym playlist is going to have EDM, hip hop, metal, like, it's going to have a bunch of different music on there. It's not just going to be reggae music only, or, you know, hip hop music only. And so understanding that mood is what's driving your decisions regarding what you're going to listen to, both as an artist, is really helpful. As an industry, you know, as a business manager, it's helpful because you can then, you know, make songs and release and market songs based on mood more so than, you know, this is the new reggae song. And as a fan, it's also the same, you know, type of thing. It's important to know that that's what's driving potentially your listening, you know, kind of decision-making factors. And it means that we can all live in, like, a simultaneous world to where there is no minor league in the music world, right? Like, my songs are in the same store as Michael Jackson, Beatles, Tupac, not to name, you know, kind of some of those guys, but like there's no minor leagues. And so you can coexist within, you know, all of these different huge artists and big labels, as long as you have the ability to consistently add fans to, you know, to your own little garden. And I think the key for us has been just what I call the consistent, cohesive release of content that's digestible enough for your fans to potentially understand. Like for me, once I learn that I like something, whether it's a TV show or sports or music, I think that it's important to make it cohesive and consistent and digestible for your fans. And same goes for if it's something I don't like. If it's something I don't want, I want to recognize that right away, acknowledge that, and not necessarily spend my time, you know, on some of that stuff. And I think that if you're consistently releasing cohesive content and you're touring properly, that is the kind of the zigzag and the seesaw of what our system consists of. And there's two really important points that I want to, you know, again, spend some time acknowledging that for me personally, once I got both of these points like hammered into my brain, it helped me traverse the, you know, what I call music industry outer space. There's different planets and galaxies and the never ending, you know, kind of music industry world. And those two points are as follows. Number one, music is subjective. So we can spend so much time, and we do spend so much time talking about what is good, what is not, what is quality, what is a hit. And the reality is that music is subjective, and there is no like right or wrong answer, you know, regarding what is better than something else. Who am I to tell, you know, you or to my dad, you know, who's like, what are you listening to? This, you know, this is garbage. And I'm like, what? This is great. I love this. There's no right or wrong answer. And as soon as I was able to keep that, you know, kind of in the front of my brain, the easier it made me, you know, kind of understand how to zigzag through all these different things, because I would always be very emotional about something that I really like. I'm like, this is a hit. This is amazing. Like, everyone's going to love it. The reality is that's not true. And there's so many songs that are extremely successful that I don't like, that I think suck, maybe even personally. I'm sure we've heard some songs on the radio or wherever, and we're like, man, I don't know. I can't even understand what this person is saying or whatever it is. And I think that the sooner we acknowledge that music is subjective, the easier and better it is we can kind of move on to, you know, actual things that can help, you know, again, potentially drive revenue. The second thing is, within the music business, there is no one right way to go about doing anything. Like, you have some people that, you know, blew up by going viral. You have some people that have been building a fan base for years and years and years. You've never seen a music video by them. You have some people who only have music videos and drop songs every month. There's just so many different like ways and strategies that exist. And again, it's important to understand and acknowledge that there is no one like right way. If there was, everybody would try and do that one right thing. And along with that, there definitely are many, many wrong ways. So it's this kind of conundrum to where there's not one right way, you know, to go about doing this, but so many wrong ways. And for us, you know, to be honest, most of the things that we've learned have been through trial and error, and through doing things the wrong way. And that's how we were able to develop our system on the management side. And our system does not necessarily work for everybody. Our system really focuses and hones in on kind of this two-part: building and maintaining an active fan base for our clients. And I think it's important to spend a little bit of time, you know, kind of breaking that down, because I'm sure we've all seen and heard bands that start to blow up a little bit or catch a buzz, and they start to build a fan base for whatever reason. And the question is, how do you maintain that and continue to grow that? And also, what is the difference between a fan versus an active fan? Right. perfect example right here with us is Big Jerry, who is a super active fan, right? He's identified something that he likes. He's, you know, following it and supporting it. Like I follow and support, you know, the Golden State Warriors or whatever it is that I am a huge, you know, active fan of. And whenever there's something that's going on, he's participating in it, whether it's going to your show, going to, you know, jumping into a live chat like this, buying merchandise, you know, streaming, listening to music, letting other people know about what he's into. He is an extremely active fan. And that to me is the most important part of, again, kind of our objective, which is building and maintaining an active fan base. Because there's very much, you know, the danger of being able to build a fan base and even able to maintain the fan base, but your fan base is very passive and inactive. So again, no disrespect to any artists, but an example, just so you know, we can kind of all maybe agree or disagree, is an artist like Fat Joe, who, again, personally, I love Fat Joe's music. You know, he's got platinum songs, platinum albums, and definitely, you know, he's someone that's been around for a really long time. However, to me, his fan base is extremely inactive. Like, they're not really tripping on him. If he posts on Twitter or Instagram that he's going to, you know, be in San Francisco or he's going to be in Berkeley at the Cornerstone, people aren't going to rush out, you know, to try to buy his tickets immediately. They're not going to really, you know, care too much. If I'm at the club and I'm chilling and having a drink and all of a sudden Fat Joe comes out and his song Lean Back comes on, great. Like, I'm going to dance and, you know, it's going to be awesome. But his fan base is extremely, to me, inactive versus someone like, let's say, again, just to, you know, kind of have some examples, someone like Stick Figure, whose fan base is so active that the moment he posts something, the moment, you know, he announces something, you know, they're all over it consistently. And so the question is, how, right? How does one build and maintain an active fan base? Like, you've done all these different things and you're building your fan base and you're trying to maintain them. And how do you maintain the activity of them? How do you maintain them to be active? And how do you identify who they are? And how do you continuously, you know, kind of grow them? And that goes back to, you know, kind of our idea of this consistent, cohesive content that is being put out, that's digestible, and that's combined with touring with a purpose. So you're not just touring over and over again in the same markets. You're releasing music, you're releasing content, and then you're touring behind that content. And I think that especially with touring, you know, kind of being down, so to speak, for right now, it still, you know, leaves what I call 90%, maybe even more, 95% of the rest of your fan base completely available to you, because the bottom line is 90 to 95% of your fans that are on Spotify or wherever else are never going to go to one of your shows. They're not going to come to a show. It's just the reality of the world. I mean, they maybe will go to a show once in a blue moon, and if so, it might be a festival or something with multiple artists on there. But the majority, again, and I'm not exaggerating the 90 to 95%, the majority of you know, your fan base is not going to ever come to your show. And I think because of that, and understanding that, especially right now, when a lot, you know, when I'm seeing a lot of just worried, you know, kind of panicked, you know, artists specifically, and it's fine. Knowing that and understanding that and spending time on creating content and releasing, you know, content and targeting your fans, your active fans, and not caring as much about anything else. Like, the biggest concern, you know, again, when we're kind of brainstorming with, let's say, Collie Buds, is what are fans going to think about this? What do our fans want? And how are they going, you know, how can we reward them to continuously be active, right? Like, what can we do to, you know, what can we do to make sure that, you know, they know that we're appreciating them, and how can we keep them active? And that's a great kind of point that Adam just dropped in the chat here. And I'll make sure to go back. I see the questions. I'll make sure to go back and address all these. But specifically, the don't let perfode, when in reality you should be focusing on catalog over perfection, continuously releasing stuff, because as a fan, I want to hear the good, the bad, and the ugly. And it's not to say that there shouldn't be like a certain, you know, level of quality that your music should have, or your, you know, or your content should have before you release it. But sometimes I just want to, you know, I wish you would just go live just like this and allow me a chance to interact with you and ask you questions. And I think that, you know, that perfection sometimes does become an enemy to progress because we get so stuck on, you know, trying to make something so perfect as opposed to creating it. And then, you know, once you get to that moment, once, you know, after a certain point, you got to have a cutoff and then you just, you know, they create a new song or, you know, create some new content. And then all of a sudden, nothing is happening with it for whatever reason, even if it's because of themselves where they don't want to release it. After a certain point in time, they just aren't as excited about that piece of work. And then it ends up in what we call purgatory, to where it doesn't come out, it doesn't get finished, and it just ends up sitting there, as opposed to if we push them as management, for example, we push them to, you know, to release this and to let it out and to get it out there. They see the response, they see the reaction, and that drives them even more to go back and to create, you know, more things. And I think a perfect example is the song, you know, the Hold Firm song that Kylie just released. Like the song, you know, the beat was made, you know, in quite a while, and it's always been like one of our favorite beats. We've always listened to it. And for whatever reason, the song just never got finished. And I think, like, you know, we really, yes, it is possible to take something out of purgatory. We were able to save, you know, the song from purgatory. And I think for Kylie, once he, you know, is hearing these other artists, you know, doing their different songs on this song, hearing their responses, you know, on it, he all of a sudden got motivated. He went back in and he did his version. And it just creates this, you know, this momentum that, you know, that builds from one thing to the next. So it's critical that when you look back as an artist, especially in years and 20 years, however many years, that you have a catalog, a body of work that is yours. And when you look at the greatest artists of all time, I'm talking all genres, no matter what they are, and you could debate me on this all you want, but there's one common denominator, you know, between all of the greatest artists, again, from the Beatles to Tupac to Bob Marley to whomever, dead or alive, Drake even, and that's the fact that they have this extensive catalog of music that if I like it, I'm going to go down that rabbit hole and I'm going to listen to it. There are certain songs that, you know, again, to me are bona fide hits from those artists, but not every song. And definitely, you know, the majority of songs probably aren't, you know, considered that. So it's just, you know, it's more so understanding like what your strategy is and being okay and comfortable within yourself as an artist to create and release. And the most important thing is that people do have an opinion on it, even if it's a negative one, because therefore you're able to drive the activity of your fans. If someone's not into this, it's not car insurance or, you know, or gym membership signups. I'm not trying to force it onto you. I'm putting it out for my fans and potentially for new fans. And now more than ever, with some of these tools that exist, it is a lot easier to identify who these people are, potentially and cater to them and allow yourself just the creative freedom as an artist to continue to evolve. Like Kylie doesn't only have to make like EPs or sorry, doesn't, I just saw the question there. It doesn't only have to make weed songs, right? He can make whatever. He can make a pop song. He can make an EDM song. He can make any kind of song he feels like as an artist. As long as, if I'm his fan, I'm the biggest Kylie fan there is, as long as he gives me what I want, a little bit of it, right, I will then be way more open in terms of giving him my ear and being open to listening to some of his other stuff without, you know, being so critical of it. And I think that's definitely, you know, a big part of this is knowing that it's okay to, you know, to be consistently releasing, but you don't have to stick to the same kind of formula every single time. And I think that in terms of this one, you know, question that I saw here, like releasing EPs versus full-length albums, what I think is people currently have what I call, you know, this ADD kind of, you know, thought process of what else, like what's next? And you might have just released a project yesterday or a song yesterday. And, you know, someone on your Facebook is like, when's your new album coming out? And you're like, what? I just released my project yesterday. And that's okay. And the point that I'm trying to make is it should be more of an individual song focus. So each song should have a campaign like an EP or an album does, because each song potentially has the ability for, you know, again, depending on one's mood, and you know, whatever they're into play a particular role in that person's life. And if you release an EP or an album all at once, probably I'm going to skim through it and pick one or two things and try to, you know, maybe listen to those, you know, at that point in time, as opposed to each song is a chance to, you know, to again, maybe get up to bat, as Adam likes to put it there, have a chance to appeal to a different type of fan, to appeal to your, you know, to your most active fans, but also potentially to new fans. And it's a chance to, you know, to grow and activate your fan base every time that you're releasing. When you release an EP or an album, you're putting all of those songs out at one time. And I'm probably going to pick two or three of them and maybe one of them and listen to them. But if I'm releasing one song at a time consistently, even if it's once a month or once a week or whatever, however long that, you know, that you can kind of, you know, however long you're able to do it, then I'm able to every single time activate my fan base. And I think that, you know, it is a part of our strategy for sure, to try to even take an EP or an album. And before, you know, it would be this huge hype and promo leading up to the release. And then the pinnacle of the campaign is when the project comes out. And now I feel really strongly that songs on an album, 5 or 6 of those songs should come out as singles before the album ever comes out. And then, yes, you will get some complaints about people. They're like, oh, you know, only 5 new songs or 4 new songs. But you'll also see that people are listening to those 5 or 4 new songs significantly more in terms of giving them that attention, because they've already heard those other songs and have identified where to put them in their minds, what mood they want to be in to listen to those songs. And so, you know, it's released. Guess what? It's already available everywhere. Go and get it. And the reason that's the case is because they have the infrastructure in place, the access directly to their fans, to just tell them, hey, boom, this is already available, and then they will go and listen to it. And for us that don't have that, or that are still building up to that, it's important to release these individual pieces, these individual songs, before the full project comes out, because that's the only time that you still as an artist have a chance to, you know, to kind of feed what you want to your fan. And when I'm reading a book, there's pages to it and I'm kind of going through it. And when albums and EPs are created, a lot of times from the artist's perspective, they are thinking about it like that. But as a fan, I'm not listening to it in that order. I'm listening to it in whatever order I want. I'm going straight to the features, or I'm going to last track, first track, whatever, you know, kind of whatever I want. And I think that it is important in terms of understanding the how to keep your fans active. You want to consistently be, you know, releasing new individual songs to them. And then after some time, definitely hit them with the project. And there might be certain songs that, you know, that you've already released that are then, you know, a part of that project. But individual songs, I would say, you know, is the way to go. Super singles, you know, 3 to 5 kind of week campaign. And if I had to pick, and this is a question I get asked all the time, if I had to pick kind of the biggest mistake and or mishap that I see happening, even from the biggest artists, is what I call this stop and go motion, right? So they will be really active for a period of time, releasing stuff. Then I won't hear from them for the next year and a half, right? Because they've just, you know, extinguished all their assets, spent time creating, you know, spent time releasing. And now, you know, for whatever reason, obviously resource-wise, it's extremely difficult to continue to create and release. But for whatever reason, they have a stop and go motion, kind of like when, you know, when I'm learning how to drive a car, as opposed to a smooth and steady motion and a consistent increase of that, you know, release ability. And so I think like the, you know, the combination of consistently releasing this cohesive content and spreading it out, if you only have very limited resources and you're, you know, you're investing all of your time and energy in mixing and mastering and videos and this, spread that campaign out, you know, so much, so that way, you know, for the next 10 weeks or 10 months, you have, you know, specific things that you could push and create that additional time to, you know, to create even more. I think that that what you call, what we would call, you know, the old music industry specifically would would be at a huge disadvantage right now, because if my peak of the, you know, my release campaign is the release and it's all downhill from there, then, you know, you're setting yourself up for an inverse kind of growth pattern. And it's even things like doing press, right? Like, everyone is, you know, I want to do this press for the release of my album. Don't do any press for the release of your album until your album is out, because once it's out and available on every single platform, and that's, you know, really simple in terms of getting it digitally distributed, then everything that you're doing press wise has the chance to, you know, get a listener. All the dominoes fall into the right place. You get on Hot 97 or you get on whatever, The Joint at Sirius XM, and I'm like, whoa, this is a great song, but I can't Shazam it immediately and listen to it, or I have no way of kind of going after it. Then, you know, I potentially have had all the dominoes fall in place and still like missed out on the opportunity to, you know, to convert a consumer. So I think like the ability to, you know, to consistently release music means that don't even start releasing really until you have enough in the done queue and enough in the done pile to, you know, to sustain this non-stop and go motion. I would rather you go really slowly, but consistently kind of go, you know, and go and go and go. And the peak of your campaign is not the release of the campaign. That's the beginning of the campaign. Now that it's out and available everywhere, yeah, then try to get press, then try to get friends and family, you know, to support it. And that's really, you know, a big part of, you know, again, why I think the most active fan bases lead to the most successful artists, because there's this community that's created like amongst, you know, the people that love what they love. So even when I'm driving in my car and I pull up to a stoplight and I see someone, you know, across the street in the same car as me, we just kind of give each other this look like, you know, what's up? Like, yeah, we both know kind of what's up, and we just kind of give each other this nod. And there's this built-in community, you know, that comes from an active fan base. And a really good example of that, again, is, you know, obviously Buds Nation and Stick Figure Family, to where it's like so amazing to see how many people there are that maybe have never met each other at all, but they're wishing each other a good day. They're checking in with each other. It's real community of people that exists. All of these people have different jobs. They work at different places. Again, not to keep bringing Big Jerry up, but, you know, with where Big Jerry works, you know, he was able to hook us up with somebody that we were trying to get access to that we weren't able to. And he was like, well, hey, I work here. You know, how can I contribute with where I work, you know, to help my favorite artist? And it's things like that that really, you know, continuously strive and push everybody else within the group. One person, you know, posts their playlist, the other person then posts it. And that inner community amongst artists is a big driving factor towards, you know, towards that like active fan base, so to speak. I saw a question about pre-orders here. And I think to me, it's not as much about pre-orders as it is about pre-saves, right? Because again, if I pre-order an album on iTunes, and again, I'm not saying don't do this, I'm saying do both, okay? Pre-order it on iTunes, sure, but make sure that you pre-save it on Spotify, pre-save it on Apple Music, because when you do those things, you instantly get a reminder when that project comes out. Because I got so much stuff going on, everybody does. I don't have time to keep track of all these different things. And how does music get discovered nowadays, right? Like if I hear something on the radio, I'm not really listening to the radio as much. Like, you know, how do you actually go about discovering music? And that's actually a question that, you know, I'd love to hear some comments on regarding like, how do you guys discover your music? Where do you go? What do you do, you know, to discover music? And for most of the people that I, you know, kind of work with, a lot of it is driven from, you know, these different playlists and these kind of recommended by suggestions. And by pre-saving something, you're definitely helping that artist, you know, improve in the algorithm. Not only are you getting a reminder of when it comes out, but you're showing Spotify, hey, there's 200 people that have pre-saved this. Maybe I should add this into this, you know, editorial playlist that maybe wouldn't normally get a look at. So I definitely think that, you know, instead of pre-ordering, drive your pre-saves. And the really cool thing about pre-saves is now with the tools that exist, something like ToneDen or Feature FM, you know, you're able to go up with pre-save without necessarily having the album done and uploaded. And I think a giant, and this is, I don't know if you guys realize how huge of a factor Pandora is, both because of the way that it has an ability to learn what you like and suggest what you like, and because there's some really key individuals that work at Pandora that are not robots, right, that are humans. So they have this combination of like amazing tech and, you know, amazing robot learning to really, like, you know, just based on what you listen to, suggest things that you may have never heard. And humans, like specifically, there's one person in mind that, you know, that I want to shout out, that allow this discovery process to happen so naturally and so organically. And on the back end, for those of you that are artists, if you look at, you know, your streams and your sales from Pandora, it probably will be first, second, or third. It'll be in the top. But if you were to really understand how much music discovery is being driven to you from Pandora, you would spend a lot more time, you know, focusing on Pandora. And they just give you so many free tools to actually use. You can go on the back end of Pandora. You can send messages, you know, voice messages to, you know, to people that are listening to you. If you're on tour, you can send messages to them based on their geo targets, and, you know, kind of based on where they are. You can just, you know, just have access to so much exclusive and unique content with explanations and kind of backstory, which I know obviously as fans, we all love from the artists. And I think that, like, you know, Pandora is such an underrated, you know, tool, because a lot of people, you know, again, are like, yeah, it's cool, I know what it does. And then everybody associates it with just automatically playing, you know, kind of songs. But now you can listen to, you know, to music on demand in, you know, on Pandora. And again, it's just from what I'm seeing in terms of trying to understand where and how music discovery is happening, Pandora is just so, so huge. And everybody that works there, and all the support that they've been given, not just huge artists when they're already huge, but artists before they are big. And that is a reason why, you know, they're getting to, you know, to kind of that point. And I think that, you know, that kind of brings me to the, to a lot of the question, you know, a lot of the questions here in terms of like how to approach playlist editors, how to get on certain playlists, because that for sure, you know, again, undeniably is a way to get exposure to new fans, that have a very high probability of becoming your fans, and to show your existing fans that, you know, they're on the right track, right? Like back in the day when, you know, when Macklemore was blowing up and I was running around, I was trying to tell my friends about Macklemore. And then all of a sudden, you know, he starts to blow up a little bit and they're like, whoa, Eags, remember you, you know, you actually told me about Macklemore, you know, a long time ago. And it is a good point about festivals here, to where major playlists definitely look at other playlists to see who else they're playing and add them to their playlist, just like with festivals, right? You notice probably that, you know, a lot of festivals potentially, you know, have very similar lineups, and that ticket history in that market. If it's Cali Roots, right, no matter who I like, no matter who I want, or Dan Sheehan likes or wants, we're checking who's selling out the Catalyst slot, you know, at Cali Roots, or at least that's one of the, you know, criteria that we're looking at. And once certain festivals see that, I know that other festivals, you know, kind of pick up on that. And, you know, festivals for sure are a great discovery tool for a lot of artists that you may not have heard of. As soon as a festival lineup gets announced, if there's an artist that I have not heard of, I'm going to check them out. Me personally, I'm definitely checking them out, because there's a reason that they're on there. It's not, you know, it's not on accident that, you know, that they're kind of getting on there. And I know that now more than ever, there's so many producers and there's so many writers, and you might be a producer, you might be a writer, but I still look at you just like an artist, right? There's no, in my mind, difference between a producer and a singer as an artist. It's all about your brand. It goes back to the, you know, to kind of doing the same things of building and maintaining, you know, an active fan base. And actually, as a producer, should be easier for you to network, get your production to certain artists, even if you're giving it to them for free, that, you know, people that you believe in that you could build with. But do you have a website? Do you have a logo? Do you have merch? Do you have, you know, tools and things that you're doing to, you know, to kind of drive, you know, people to you? And it's no excuse or no reason, because they have the ability to own and retain a whole separate portion of publishing and music royalties that, you know, that they're not necessarily, that they wouldn't necessarily have access to. So someone like Stick, who produces and writes, you know, all of his own music and damn near mixes it as well, I think that, you know, he is able to independently free because he has additional revenue that's not just based on sales and streams. So you actually have a pretty big advantage, you know, as a producer, or as a songwriter. And again, if you going back to the very beginning, if you spend the time to learn and understand how things work and how to monetize, you know, your music, you might never, ever even go on tour and still be financially, you know, successful. And I think that there's so many tools that exist. For example, Songtrust is a great tool, because not that you have to sign up for them, but they just have the most extensive explanation of what publishing royalties are, what the different kind of publishing royalties are, how do I collect them, how do I know like how much they're even supposed to be. And for me, it's just like in math class back in the day, which, you know, I wasn't great at necessarily, but if and when I could turn to my, you know, kind of partner next to me and explain to them how to do this math equation, then I also would feel, you know, comfortable and confident even more so into how it works. And again, every day or once a week at least, like, I'm going back to Songtrust. I'm like, all right, hold on, wait a minute. Like, how does this work again? And like, just spending the time to learn and understand how those things are working, so that way you understand how to monetize your music. And the majority of artists, even the biggest artists and the biggest labels, are not fully properly monetizing their catalog. They're not collecting all their royalties. They don't understand how to impact the things that most drastically impact, you know, their royalties. And so in times like this, it's a lot harder for them to survive, as opposed to the artists that maybe have, you've never heard of, they have way less total followers and fans, but they do understand how it works. And they are able to, you know, to survive. And, you know, again, this is unprecedented what's happening now, but, you know, they are able to survive slower periods of non-touring or no touring at all. And I think that goes back to their ability to not just do the cool, fun, sexy stuff, but also the boring, tedious learning stuff. And to me, it's not boring and tedious, but to some people, you know, if at a show, it's exciting, there's fans. And one thing that, you know, that I do want to point out is that our system was definitely built on and around the live, like, scene, before we started, you know, kind of focusing on the, you know, consistent, cohesive content side, right? We're promoters and talent buyers first and foremost. And as a fan, for me, like, when I saw, I'm a fan of Method Man, but when I saw him perform at the Catalyst, I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. I became, from a fan to an active fan, like, I was like, I have to tell somebody immediately, you know, about like some of this stuff. And I think, you know, to kind of answer this question real quick, as far as books, I don't have any good books to recommend, because every time I find a book that I'm into, by the time, you know, I get to it, by the time I read it, by the time I'm going over it, it's damn near obsolete. That is a problem. And that's one of the reasons why when I was going to school, I was like, great, I love music, I'm going to study music business. And like, even in just sitting in some of those classes, like, I'm like, what are they talking? This is not relevant at all anymore. And what is relevant and what is better than books is the internet, right? Like, go again, use forums, use Songtrust, go to Sound Exchange, go to BMI, go to these, you know, these sites. YouTube is like amazing, right? You can Google anything. How to collect, you know, how do I know if I'm collecting all my royalties? How do I know how to even explain to my artist, you know, that, hey, what's the difference between your mechanical royalties and your publishing royalties? And just, you know, so many endless things. It gets pretty confusing, scary, overwhelming. But if you just keep at it and keep, you know, kind of keep kind of plugging away at it, it will become easier and it definitely becomes, you know, clearer. And I think like something that, again, with all the changes, with all these crazy changes, one of the things that has not changed and is not changing is the merchandising side of things, right? So there was this point in time, which was really scary within the music industry, and I remember it very clearly, when music was free completely, because I would just go to Napster or LimeWire and download whatever song I wanted to, you know, kind of just right away, and just listen to it, right? And so because of that, you know, it made it extremely difficult to monetize selling your music, because I could download it for free. And one thing that we know is we can't download a t-shirt for free, right? Like you have to actually purchase, you know, physical goods, and you have to, you know, you have to try to make sure that you're bundling your music with physical goods. And I actually kind of moved away from liking the term merchandise, because when I thought about merchandise, I would just think, you know, just remind me of like band shirts that like you wash one time and then they get, you know, they get broken or they get like, you have to throw them away. And instead think about it like a brand, right? Like you're building your brand, your merchandise is a part of your brand. And I want my merchandise to be just as quality as anything you'd see in a major store. I don't want it to say Hanes on the tag of my Collie Bud shirt. You know, I wanted to say Collie Buds on my Collie Bud shirt. I want to have the ability to create merchandise that, you know, when Big Jerry or any of the fans, you know, kind of purchases, they are like, you know, proud to wear it and that it matches the quality of any of the other products that they would potentially buy, because everybody only has so much buying power. And if you're asking them to, you know, to purchase you and support you, you better give them quality product. And you have to be, again, consistently releasing product that makes sense, that fits in with your brand. And again, Stick Figure does such an amazing job of that. He has, I think, I don't know, maybe Adam, you could tell, you could correct me, but something like a couple hundred SKUs of different products, dog toys, baby things, like just everything that you could imagine. But all of it is quality, and it's about building it out slowly. You can't, you know, necessarily just come out with 50 different things at once, but you can once every so often release a new item. And there definitely is now, again, these tools like print on demand style options like Printify and Printful that allow you to, you know, test out different designs and let, you know, let the market, let your fans decide and tell you kind of what you think is going to work or not. I know, like for us, like the Blind to You Haters shirt that I'm sure, you know, we've all seen at different places, some people within the camp weren't fans of it, right? They were like, this is corny. Like, it's just as Blind to You Haters. And like, what's so cool about this, you know? And the bottom line is the market dictates that people love it, right? They want to wear it. You could see it far from this, you know, like on stage. And I think that merchandise will and has and will remain one of those constants, like touring, you know, like bearing unprecedented times like this, to where you can use it to not only grow your fan base, but to generate revenue and to drive the activity, you know, of your fans. There are certain shirts, certain hats, that I see that I know for a fact, if you have one of those, like you're somebody special, right? Like, cause we've only released a certain amount of those and you know, that each one kind of holds like a, you know, a particular, place in whatever, in history and whatnot. And I think like, again, the most successful brands and bands, regardless of whether you're a producer or whatever it is that you're doing on the music side, are able to utilize merchandise to, both drive revenue, and really keep that fan base extremely, extremely active. All right, let's scroll through some of these questions because I could just keep rambling, you know, all day. And I, you know, it's just never ending ramble here. Okay, it's a great question here. For newer artists that are newer to the scene, what are good ways to provide value for bigger artists that you want to network with? And this is from Brandon. One way that he's brought, you know, value to other artists is by writing blog posts. And I think that's a good point. And what I was going to say is that one way to, you know, to not just add value, but to show and prove value is to be a supporter, right? Support other people's shit. Talk, you know, like repost them, go to show. Like, it's the same thing. How do I get on these shows? Go to shows, right? Meet the promoters, meet the people that are there, you know, prove value and show value by being a supporter. I think that is one of the bigger kind of ways to, you know, to kind of go about making sure that you're able to, you know, to get the attention of certain artists. And at the end of the day, artists are just people, right? Like, I mean, some people are whack, some people are cool. And like someone like Eric Rachmani, who's one of the biggest artists ever, is one of the most humblest, down to earth, like just nicest guys ever. Like, I don't even think I've ever seen him angry. And it's like, you know, each artist is completely different, has his own different personality, and don't set your kind of, you know, your hopes too high. Like, if I meet Stephen Curry and he's a dickhead, like, I'm not going to be upset about it. Right. Like, 'cause I don't really know him at all. And I'm just putting on these, you know, kind of having these assumptions about this person, based on whatever it is I'm thinking. And I think that, like, it is important to, you know, to show value by being a supporter and understanding what, at least trying to understand what is important to that person or that artist. That goes for anything, right? If I'm trying to get on a playlist or if I'm trying to do whatever, that's what I want. What does this person want? Yeah, that's my dad working on the house. I'm gonna text him right now and tell him to stop. Stop the noise. I am live on YouTube. ASAP. So my dad can't sit still, and he's, you know, he's literally, I don't even know what he's building right now or what he's doing, but that's the noise that you're, you know, that you're probably hearing in the background. So I just texted my mom. Hopefully she sees it and tells him to cool it. Yeah. Oh, nope. She's going to tell him. All right, let me scroll up here and see what other questions you have. So yeah, I mean, hopefully that answered your question. You could hear it over the loud note. I can hear my mom yelling at my dad downstairs now, telling him he's on YouTube, and he's like, "What is YouTube?" Like, he's trying to ask her what it is. So yeah, I mean, again, I would just say, in terms of proven value, try to understand as a person and as a business, the other, you know, the person that you're dealing with and what is it that, you know, they might be into. And Brandon did a great job of being able to show value by writing these very thought-provoking blog posts about that person and what they were doing. And the way he would write these blog posts, it's not necessarily that, okay, there's this millions of people that are seeing it, but the way he would write them, he would demonstrate the fact that he spent a lot of time in identifying and breaking down what is it, you know, the things that he was listening to, and he would point out certain things that the artist would appreciate more than anyone else, right? Like, the artist spent so much time on doing these things, and, you know, all of a sudden he's pointing out these intricate little details for other people and just, you know, just for himself. The artist recognized that and acknowledged that, and I think that's why, you know, he gets a lot of love, and also because he's there, right? You'll pop up. I wouldn't be surprised to see him at any show across the country. Like, literally, would not be surprised if I hit the corner and boom, he's in the middle of the dance floor dancing. All of a sudden, coming in buying merch, and I have to be like, okay, like, dude, you already bought all this stuff. Like, and he's like, nope, I'm buying it again. Like, he's involved in the scene, and he makes it so, you know, he has to be seen and heard. And I definitely think that, you know, that's definitely important. Obviously, you know, Kara and the SoCal Street Team crew are a really good example of that as well, because, you know, they make it possible to have like real humans that you can reach out to that, you know, are just as big as fans as you are, when it comes to this music. They're not going to you know, take these posters and that I spent the last, you know, dollars that I have on and dump them in the garbage. No, they're going to distribute them accordingly and appropriately in places that they do business at. Like if I'm going into a liquor store, for example, yeah, maybe every single other person that asks to put a poster up in the store says no, but I come in here and buy Red Bull every single day, my G. So please let me put this up here. And, you know, and that does lead to so much more placement and so much more access. And again, it just, it allows us as an independent community to rely on each other to, you know, to kind of help push things forward. And that's why, and whenever there's a tour going on, you'll probably see SoCal Street Team involved in it. Because as managers, as artists, we know what they bring to the table. We understand that. And even outside of that, even when you don't see them, they're at the shows, you know, like in the front row, singing every single song. And the amount of people that they bring with them in terms of like new people that like, you know, that maybe have never heard of you. Like with Kali, I always try to ask, like, you know, where did you, and it's like, oh, I learned, I came with Kara for the first time. And then I was hooked, you know, from forever. And as one person and her, you know, and her kind of her group of friends, the amount of people that that they're responsible for in terms of driving towards a lot of our artists is astronomical. Like, it's, you know, it's crazy. And so if we had more people that were willing to spend, you know, some of their time on just shining some light on, you know, it doesn't have to be fake, right? If you're not into it, you don't have to promote it or push it. But if you are, spend some time telling somebody else about it, and spend some time trying to bring some, you know, some value to the table for, you know, for that person. Let me scroll up here and see who we got here. It looks like my dad stopped working. Good. Jerry brings up a good point. When you wear somebody's merch and you're walking around, that also is, you know, really important in terms of helping them build, because they might just like the really cool smoking bear on your t-shirt and they might not know that, you know, what shirt that is or what band that's from. But, you know, it's definitely a driving factor towards, you know, towards consistently, you know, new fans and active fans that are existing, kind of working together to, you know, to say, hey, where did you get this Kali Buds hat? Got it at KaliBuds.com. And yes, there are some available there. And I'm glad to see that, you know, Irene, who's been a Kali Buds fan since probably before I started working with Kali Buds, which is 11 years ago, she's mentioned here that her shirts haven't faded over the years. I'm glad to hear that. And I bet you know how to wash them properly as well. And that's a big reason to, you know, to make sure that they don't get faded. Let's see. I'm scrolling up here. Book recommendations we kind of talked about a little bit, and Reed maybe can drop some more stuff in there for you guys if you really want to, you know, to kind of read up on some stuff. I would suggest just scalping and going on the internet and Googling and YouTubing, and there's so many forums and webinars. Even just this week, like I took a Zoom webinar that this company called Audium had, which was how to understand if you're, you know, if you're collecting your publishing royalties and where to, you know, what are some ways to actually match up the statement that you get from whomever you're getting it to a real thing to see if they, you know, if they're working. Let's see, going up here, going up. Good point here in terms of the live show. So no matter what happens as an artist, in terms of who your manager is, who your label is, how many fans you got, no matter what, the reason that we built, you know, originally and really started building our system on and around the live side was because there's this moment on stage where you either win the crowd over or you don't, right? Like, let's say I'm here to see J. Cole. I don't even care about anything else. Like, hurry up and let's get J. Cole on. You come on stage and you kill it, like, that's impressive to me, right? I'm like, oh, wow, like, this, you know, potentially this is cool. And again, no matter what your manager does or no matter what kind of marketing you have, certain people just have that ability to win a crowd over. And obviously those people would, you know, would be a lot more successful on the touring side than, you know, than people that have a lot, you know, a harder time doing that. But performing is like anything else. You can get better at it with practice. Yeah, I said practice. Don't tell Allen Iverson. With practice, you can get better. I've seen it happen over the years to where, you know, certain people like Kylie, for example, who never satisfied. Like, he comes off stage, I'm like, oh, this show is the best show ever. He's like, nah, there was these five things that were wrong and this and this and this, because he always wants to get better. And he works on that. And I think that, you know, that is important, but it's a really good point that, you know, the live show does have to be spectacular, you know, in order to kind of win the crowd over, especially today, especially if I don't already know you. If I'm coming to see somebody else and, you know, boom, like I'm all of a sudden, you know, stuck watching this 10 openers or whatever, it potentially could decrease the quality of the show. But if I'm open-minded and in certain markets, and that's why we love playing in secondary markets like a Santa Cruz, where the fans, they will let you know if they like you or not. Like LA, everyone is really cool. And then again, no offense, but everyone's really cool and it gets a lot to get them to like rock out, right? But Santa Cruz, if you're rocking, they'll rock with you. And if you're sucking, they'll boo you. And it's not, you know, they're not too cool for school. Like, you know, they're there with an open mind and they will, you know, kind of be receptive to an amazing performance. But you can definitely win over fans and gain fans, like kind of like what we call the, you know, the Coliseum for gladiators, like potentially let me in there and, you know, I'll take my chances because I feel confident in my abilities. And you do have to, you know, you do have to be able to put on an amazing show, and you have to consistently change what your show is. You got to add lighting and all this, you know, all these different things to increase the production, to increase the production value. But having a really good live show is really important. And as we see now, like, you know, without any live shows, it sucks, right? Like, not just because I'm in the business, but because I miss going to, you know, and seeing these people and interacting with them. And I'm a big sports fan. And it's like, I can watch, and I do watch the majority of sporting events from home, but there's no way you could replace going to a live event. I'm like hugging and high-fiving, you know, a grown-ass man next to me that I don't even know, based on, you know, we're both screaming and yelling and happy and experiencing this kind of, you know, this thing together. That's not something that could be replaced ever. So the live side, you know, super important, obviously. Let's see, going up here. Roof Fire Curators, big up to those guys, killing it on the Apple playlists, killing it on Spotify. And I don't think you guys know how much time, you know, and energy they spend on continuously updating these lists, finding things that they think you guys are going to enjoy, giving shine to, you know, to artists that don't necessarily, you know, have that from somewhere else because they're lesser known artists. And, you know, again, really spending time as humans to, you know, to kind of better the scene. And I spent, you know, almost an hour today just talking to Reed about the Root Fire playlist. Reed, maybe you can drop that in here. And if you guys can at least follow it and stay up on it, that would be great. Such a simple, you know, kind of thing to do there. Let's see here. Going through. Miles, as far as plans for artist courses, I think, you know, there are a lot of these different plans that are always out there. And I think one of the good things about kind of what's happening right now is the time to, you know, to go and actually do some of these things. And I know that there's a really cool program. I think it's called Backstage Musicians, started by Stick Figures drummer Kevin, which allows fans the opportunity to, you know, sign up and actually get lessons from some of their favorite artists at these tour stops. It provides an additional revenue for some of those artists who, you know, maybe don't make as much money or whatnot. And it really allows for that one-on-one interaction amongst, you know, amongst fan to, you know, to artists. And it is really cool to see that happening digitally now more than ever, to where you can, you know, learn how to play a certain guitar riff. And, you know, things like Patreon are really important. I know that the Expendables just launched, you know, their Patreon, and they have some really cool options in there to where, you know, they can teach you how to play certain things. And I do think that on the music business side, one of the things that we want to try to do with, you know, with broadcasts like this is also have the same, you know, kind of level of ability to go in and, you know, it's not like this lecture necessarily. It's more so, let's learn from each other. Let's see what's working for you. Let's talk about these things. Let's devil's advocate these things. And let's, you know, let's kind of work together on them. And I know that, you know, hopefully this could be like an ongoing thing. But I know that specifically for if you're an artist and you're looking to kind of get an expert opinion from another artist or learn how to do certain things, backstage musicians are great for that. Let me scroll down here. Okay. Yep. Thank you for putting that in there. Yeah, Kevin, you know, he's doing an amazing job because it's not a fake thing. Like he's really connecting fans with their heroes to teach them. And speaking of heroes, looks like Mr. Pee-wee Bonsu is in the house. And Mr. Pee-wee Bonsu is one of the people that for me served as, you know, kind of like the godfather of teaching me how to think about all this stuff and not just relying on, you know, precedent from what's happened 5 or 10 years ago and being comfortable and confident in your own thought process, even if it's different from everybody else. And so while most people were like, not sure about this Igor and Thomas guys, like they're young kids and, you know, who knows what they're talking about with this website and merch things, he was receptive to it and actually gave us a chance when nobody else would, you know, would listen to us or want to even listen to us. And I think, you know, we definitely by like Ineffable wouldn't be where we are today if it wasn't for the hours and hours of conversation that Pee-wee and, you know, had with us over the phone until the wee hours of the night, brainstorming these different strategies, even though we both know that, you know, a lot of this stuff is subjective and there is no like one right way to do it. There is still so much time that needs to go into planning, and being okay with doing something that's different and being okay with taking a swing and missing, right? Like I can't have a situation to where one of my clients is like, yo, Eags, you said we should do this playlist thing and we did it and it sucks. And I'm like, well, yeah, maybe I was wrong, right? But I want to be in the batter's box just swinging away, trying different things. And I think, again, Pee-wee really empowered us to use our own perception as to what's happening right now because with how fast things change and, you know, and apply that. And he helped us, you know, kind of convince some of the others on the team to, you know, to try things like, hey, let's put out this EP for free download. You're going to get it for free anyway. So I'm giving it, you know, I'm going to give it to you for free. And I think like the what I call the coaching tree, like, you know, there's Greg Popovich and there's all these coaches that kind of come from him. Pee-wee is that to us, right? Like he was one of the ones that was, you know, took us under his wing and helped us in real scenarios try these things. And when things worked, you know, regardless of whose idea it is or who's, you know, kind of saying what, he would be the first one to acknowledge that. And also he'd be the first one to bring us down to earth when things, you know, needed to, and just be honest and transparent and communicate directly as an inner team and an inner cocoon behind closed doors. You might think we're damn near arguing and yelling, right? But we're not. We're conversating, we're debating, we're, you know, doing this to kind of make things better in front of other people. Not going to see it at all, right? But behind closed doors, it's okay to go in and, you know, if you have a strong like inner cocoon, you know, of your kind of your team, you know, you should be able to express how you feel. And I learned a lot of that. We learned a lot of that from Pee-wee and from Kali. And so, you know, it's cool to see him even here now. I mean, you know, he doesn't need to be in here listening to all this stuff. He's here as well. And again, it just goes to show that the learning process never ends. If you are like me, who the more I do this, the more addicted I get to it, then you can definitely be successful in this stuff. And if you're going to turn away at the first obstacle or the fourth obstacle, then it's, you know, it's probably not for you. And there's for sure music is for everybody in terms of we all love it, but the music business is not for everybody. And another person, you know, I see here in the group is Nico, who, again, you guys probably don't know this, but Nico probably mixed every song damn near, all of your favorite songs that you hear from all your favorite artists. Like, if I made the list, we'd have to have a whole separate, like, group, you know, conversation for that. He's mixed their, you know, music and gotten it to that point and helped progress it from this, you know, oh, I want it to be perfect to this is as perfect as it's going to get. And so many artists on the back end trust his ear and his opinion that again, by having him on the team, we're actually able to get songs out, because I'm not an expert when it comes to a lot of this stuff, right? You, Kali asked me and I'm like, bro, this sounds great. It's ready. You know, it sounds amazing. It's ready to go as far as I'm concerned. Like, let me upload this now. And when, you know, when Nico is talking to him and when Nico is explaining to him, you know, he's an expert at what he does, and the trust factor is there. And it's so difficult to, you know, to take somebody else's vision and combine that with your own vision and do it in a way that, like, you know, that does make the song so much better. And, you know, I think, like, just, again, seeing him in here and knowing, like, what he does on a regular basis without anybody knowing that he's doing these things, is, you know, is very cool. And I think that, you know, I wanted to give him some acknowledgement. I know I saw Noah in here as well, who does a lot of the live sound for Kali and mixes a lot of other people. And, you know, again, it's a very thankless kind of job and thankless position. I'll change this and do this. But ultimately, it's so critical, just because without him, I'm telling you, every song would still be in purgatory for all of your favorite artists. Like, it's no joke. And once one or two artists find out about that, you know, it continues that momentum trend, and all of a sudden it's like, okay, you're mixing this artist now, you're mixing this artist now. You know, it's been heaven sent to have somebody with his skill set and personality, to be able to, you know, to make sure that the rest of us fans just hear the music and we're like, oh, great, Kali probably did this in 10 minutes. And they don't know the amount of time spent on mixing just one little tiny snare or, you know, just adjusting certain things. Oh, it looks like, thanks to you guys, Adam has just informed us that Hold Firm just hit 100,000 streams on Spotify. And to some people, you know, again, that's not a lot of streams, but to us, that's huge. The song just came out a couple days ago. One thing that I'm really, you know, kind of proud of is that on the same day that we released that song, without any major label, without anything, you know, I know that there was an Alicia Keys song that came out, you know, with Chronix and Prodigy on there. And, you know, we're definitely crushing them right now on the streams. And it's a friendly competition. It's definitely something that, like, is attributed to the fact that you guys as a community are actually in there listening to the song and liking it. Like, my daughter is like, Daddy, I want to listen to Kali Buds to, you know, put this particular song on. And it's huge to us. We sit here and we hit refresh. We watch it, look at, you know, it's 55,000 streams for, you know, for the Alicia Keys song. And I'll tell you this, the reason that we have more streams than them is really due to, again, no disrespect to anyone, but the lack of either time and attention and or understanding of how to properly release and monetize a song. They should have 10 times more streams than we do on Spotify right now, based on, you know, Alicia Keys alone, she has 18 million followers or something like that. I'm sure Adam is probably looking that up right now. Looks like there's more work going on there. But I think, you know, looking at the smaller, non-fun, non-sexy things like that, and understanding what they are, getting with people that do understand what they are, and applying them and seeing what's working is for sure the reason why we have more, you know, streams right now than they do. It's not about what song is better, because that's subjective. And clearly their numbers are way, way, way more than ours currently. But with less people, we can do more things. Like with One Big Jerry, we can have, you know, the equivalent of 1,000 fans with the amount, you know, that he's supporting and with the amount of just time and energy, you know, potentially that he's putting towards us. And like, if you compare, again, just look in the chat here, the monthly listeners for her, monthly listeners for Kali. And I mean, even for Kali, like 1.2 million people monthly are listening to Kali Buds on Spotify. Like, that's crazy to me. Like, that's so many people. But most of those people are never coming to a show, right? So if you're worried right now as an artist about the fact that there aren't tours and you can't go outside, you should be. But don't let that prevent you from seeing the bigger picture here, which is you can still be viable. You can definitely still be successful. You don't need to be signed to, you know, a major label or, you know, or to Ineffable, to, you know, to be successful. This information is out there. And, you know, we just got to continue to know that we have to learn more. And I think like the coolest thing to me about what's happening right now in music is the fact that all that really needs to happen on the artist side is you need to create and release music. Like, you know, when I say it like that, and, you know, as we're talking about these things, it's seems like it's such a simple thing, but how cool is that, that now, as opposed to before, where you had to jump through these hoops and, you know, wear shiny suits and get signed and give up the rights to your music. Now you don't need to do any of that. You really just have to create music and release music. And, you know, by doing so, you will hopefully, you know, slowly for some, faster for others, continue to build your fan base. And the more you do that, the more you'll see that you're going to want to do that. And so it's just, you know, it turns into a real positive thing. And I know from touring with Kali for, you know, for so long that it's impossible to maintain this level of like Superman forever, right? Like eventually you're going to have kids. Eventually you're going to, you know, be in a scenario to where you're not going to be able to go on the road as much. And, you know, if you can continue to create and release music, you will always continue to keep your fan base active, even if they're growing slowly. And then when you do tour, it's just going to do so much better, right? Like you don't have to be touring in stadiums. The best shows, I'm sure, you know, some of the artists will tell you, are in smaller and mid-sized venues where it's more intimate and the crowd is right there. And it looks like Mike Love just joined. And one thing I really love and learned a lot from Mike is after every single show, no matter how tired he is, no matter what's going on, he goes out in the crowd and talks to every single one of his fans and hugs them and, you know, and says thank you to them. And like, first I'm like, all right, let's see how long this goes, you know, and I'm not sure. But every single show, and again, if you guys have been to a Mike Love show, you would see that. And I think that probably more than anything else is such a driving factor to why his fans love him, you know, so much. And then when they see how like talented and skilled he is, you know, it's just, you know, it brings them to that uber active fan even more so. I guess no hugging currently, but just social distancing and talking after the show. But, you know, the point is like interacting with your fans and showing them that, you know, that you appreciate them. I don't think I've ever seen anybody kind of, you know, do it in that way. And I think that, you know, it's really special as a fan just to, you know, to kind of see so many people and their, you know, their response to, you know, to him doing that. And, you know, it's just a cool thing that, that continues to grow, you know, kind of from one thing to the next. Definitely some virtual hugs. I saw a question here about a publicist. Okay. So give me my thoughts on PR. Okay. So personally, I think, and I could be wrong, majority of publicity outside of things like late night TV, maybe the majority of publicity does not get you fans. Okay. Like if I don't know you and I see you in a magazine, whatever, Hip Hop DX or whatever it is, I'm probably not going to click on it. Like it's just the facts, right? And what it does for the artists, it more so gives tools and ammo for the artist and his team to be able to use these, you know, kind of one quote from Billboard that says, you know, Kez Namdi's new album is the best album of all time or whatever. You know, one sentence from them isn't necessarily going to change his fan base per se, but it is going to now allow me to go to my agent and allow me to go to certain promoters, allow me to go to certain playlist editors, allow me to go back to, you know, to all of these other gatekeepers with this as a piece of ammo that does, you know, lead to progress. So if you're spending, and I've had a lot of frustration, I'm sure, you know, Pee-wee and some of the guys in here too, where I've spent $10,000, $12,000 on a PR campaign and got nothing, like $12,000, and it's just gone. Like, where do we get? We got a couple articles on Reggaeville or on somewhere else. And I love Reggaeville. And the reason I love Reggaeville is because they cover the scene, right? They really cover the scene. They really are looking for certain things that are out there and putting it up and supporting it. But the point of that is that why spend that $12,000 on a publicist, and unless you're managing your own expectations of what you're getting out of that, right? So if I don't have a huge budget or a lot of resources, I personally would put you know, getting a publicist towards the, you know, the bottom part of necessities. And I apologize to any publicists if there are any here. It's not to say they aren't important, but I would suggest that you do what you can to build your own relationships with these people that you want, you know, publicists to reach out to, right? Like, if you can, if you want to get on, you know, thefader.com, go to their Instagram, go to their website, find out who the editors are, find out what other articles they wrote, reach out to them, you know, on social media, figure out what they want, and, you know, and try to build your own relationships kind of with them. I think that would be, you know, the bigger recommendation, and save that spend on, you know, on creating a music video or creating some kind of content that you can then bring to a publicist, right? So before you even get to the publicist's point, like, spend money to make your, you know, your content really quality and have more of it. Because again, from what I've seen, I just don't necessarily think that you gain a huge amount of fans or almost any fans from, you know, from publicists. More so these tools and kind of ammo that you can use for other things. And you are your own publicist or your manager, like half the day, right? Like on the management side, we're serving as a publicist, we're reaching out to publications, we're, you know, fielding and shifting through interviews and trying to, you know, trying to make sure that our message is getting out there. And we're trying to build our own relationships with these outlets. So that way I know that the editor of Fader's got this amazing poodle, and, you know, so, you know, next time I reach out to him, I'm going to ask him, how's your poodle doing? And da 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 da, et cetera, et cetera. And so, you know, we have our own rapport, we have our own relationship. And so when I'm telling them, you know, when I'm bringing something new to them that maybe they haven't heard of, they will potentially be a lot more receptive to it. Right, absolutely. Say, you know, like for booking, for Spotify playlists, for everything else, the publicist side of things, you know, it can help, but I would save that big spend and invest in, you know, in a different part of your campaign, and more so try to build out those relationships. Now, if you have an unlimited budget, and if you can get on, let's say, late night TV, I mean, I've seen like late night TV be one of the only like things that does drive at least some attention towards you. And most of that attention is from other people that are like, they're already heard of you. They're like, oh, whoa, you know, you are now on, you know, this late night show. You must, you know, be blowing up, right? And you have, you know, you definitely have some traffic that comes from people that, you know, that maybe saw you or heard of you on, you know, on a late night show. But again, the majority of people that don't know you, when they see you, you know, unless you're doing some kind of amazing thing immediately, probably aren't going to check for you. And if it does happen and your project isn't out at the time, you're wasting it even more, because now all these things happen the way you wanted them to, but you're not able to capitalize on that because it's not available or it's not going to be, you know, happening at that time. And one of the things that Kez and I always kind of, you know, talk about is, should we send these songs to these DJs, right? On the one hand, yes, I want to send, you know, I want to send these new songs to these DJs before they come out. And this is actually a good, you know, a good tip is we try to keep a lot of the main curators and a lot of the, you know, kind of main gatekeepers in tune with the process as it's happening, because we value their opinion, right? Like if Big Koa, who supports everything we do in Hawaii and has been just so, you know, critical to, you know, to our artists and our growth, if I have something that's not quite ready yet, I'm going to send it to him and get his opinion on it, right? Like, and he'll tell me straight up the real deal, like, yo, I love this new song that Kez Namdi has with Tory Lanez. It's a banger. I'm going to listen to it. I'm adding it right now to my gym playlist damn near. But it doesn't fit the format of Hawaii radio, right? However, this type of song does. And so now with real information that I'm getting, you know, along the way, I'm able to apply that towards our campaign and, you know, and able to ultimately, like, you know, just kind of make sure that we're keeping these curators in tune as these things are happening and asking them their opinions, right? And asking their feedback. I know Pat McKay obviously is a huge, help in all this as well, because she's honest and she will tell, you know, us really what she thinks and what we need to do. And that's all that I ask for, right? I can't like ask that everyone's just going to love and just immediately take everything I send them and play it. But I just want to be able to go back to my artist and go back to Kez or Kylie or whomever and say, yo, sorry, they said like we're not getting on because it's not the right format, right? Or they don't like it or anything, something, as opposed to just no response and no answer and no direction. And I think like the most successful, you know, the most successful artists and most successful teams are able to leverage the relationships that they've built and the feedback from those, you know, kind of relationships to apply to their campaigns and to make things better. And if you're not, if somebody's suggesting something to you, you know, and you're not applying that, you're not coachable, you're not, you know, you're not kind of open to some of this, then, you know, you can't feel a certain way when it doesn't, you know, when it doesn't happen. So let's see here. We got Tim, drummer who has toured for signed artists before. How do I get a solid gig? Well, the thing about getting any kind of solid gig is like the same question of how do I get, you know, a solid girlfriend or how do I get, you know, a solid friend? It's a trial and error process that most likely will end up in, you know, in not necessarily the best circumstances. But eventually, I'm a really strong believer if you're putting good energy out there and trying and, you know, making yourself available when others won't and can't, that is something that will lead to, you know, to getting a steady gig and a solid gig with somebody. And it's hard because, you know, as the years go by, people change and not like necessarily of their own control, again, having kids or, you know, having certain family circumstances and certain opportunities pop up. And if you're the type of artist that can make it happen at a short notice, potentially you're sacrificing a lot, but you're putting yourself in the best position, you know, to get a solid gig. And to me, a solid gig is one that isn't necessarily the best paying gig. It's one that values my, you know, expertise, my opinion, and that I enjoy, you know, working at. So one of the, my favorite, you know, kind of parts of the Kali crew and the band is I like everybody in the team, on the team, you know, I enjoy being on the road with them. I feel like, you know, I'm on the road with my friends and I feel like, you know, everybody cares about everybody. Sounds kind of silly and stupid. And I know for a fact that I can make more money if I was doing something else at that particular time. But also by all of us sacrificing and committing at that same time, we're showing each other that this is the most important thing for us. And I think that, you know, again, leads to some longevity. But as a, you know, as a drummer, like it's hard to find a good drummer, you know, it's hard to find a good drummer that can travel. It's hard to find a good drummer that could get along with everybody, you know, within the crew and that, you know, that can take care of all the equipment, set it up and et cetera. So I think, you know, as long as you're making yourself available and willing to, you know, kind of to take that leap when the opportunity presents itself, you should be in a good position to, you know, to get a good gig and, you know, your chops are on point as well. Journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step from Big Jerry. I'll scroll up here real quick because I think there was some good questions in the beginning that that I missed. Let me see here. There was a question about a song spend, I think it was, that I was looking for. Here's one. Do you have any tips on marketing your music? Do you lean more towards online marketing or is it more advantageous to tour and get word of mouth type of exposure? So, I mean, I know we've talked a lot already about, you know, a lot of these different types of marketing strategies that exist. And I'm, again, really a firm believer that now the tools that we have make it easier than ever to market directly to your fans. For example, if you are strictly going on the digital side, something like YouTube, which has this True View, and again, I don't know if Nima's in here, but Nima and Verticals can, you know, can be a really good resource for this. They have these True View ads that allow you to, you know, select other artists that are similar to yourself and other songs, and they pop up as, you know, like a video commercial at the end of one of those songs. And if somebody watches that commercial for 30 seconds and or clicks it, two things happen. One, if they watch it for 30 seconds or more, you monetize that view as an artist. So you're literally, you know, monetizing the ability for that person to watch and see kind of, you know, the video that you put out there. But also, you're not getting charged unless they do that. So it's an amazing spend, and it's probably one of the better spends that digital spends that's out there, which allows you to target like very accurately, almost specifically exactly what you want. And it doesn't charge you unless somebody watches it all the way through. And if somebody watches all the way through, then the chances of them liking it, again, are probably more. Otherwise, why would they sit there and continue to watch it? So if you have a brand new music video that comes out and you're spending, you know, again, $100 or $1,000 on these TrueView ads, which comes to something like 10 cents, you know, per view, which you're able to make a little bit of that back because you're actually monetizing on that view. But more importantly, you're able to potentially entice somebody that hasn't heard of you to come and check out your music, right? And I think that's something that, you know, I've seen that works. But also at Ineffable, like, we're big fans of good old-fashioned street promo, right? Like, I know that's, it might be a little bit wasteful now to have flyers and posters and just get out and talk to people, but I know every single person I talk to is going to become a Collie Buds fan or has a good chance, because I'm going to be so excited and passionate about talking to them about that person that they will be. And I think, you know, for those of us that know Mr. David Parnes, he's a great example of that. Like, single-handedly, like, you know, everybody that he talks to, you know, they're going to know the Reese Brothers. They're going to support them from that point. And then they check him out and then they're like, oh, wow. Like, damn, these guys are really talented. Like, holy shit. So I think, you know, the combination of digital, street promo, you know, and a lot of these other things that exist are, you know, the way to do it. Word of mouth for sure is always the best, just because, you know, again, as one person, you know, you can articulate how you feel and what, you know, describe what you want. And there's that trust factor, right? Like, people that I know and that know me trust that I'm not going to send them some bullshit. So if I'm like, yo, you got to listen to this Kez Namdi album, trust me, this album is amazing, they're going to give it a shot and they're going to give it a listen, and then they can make their own decision over time. And for me, the things that, you know, have worked really well is, you know, there was the peewees in the world that like did listen. But then the majority of the people, they did not listen. And over time, the fact that they did not listen actually proved more advantageous to me, because I can go back and pinpoint and say, yo, I've been telling you about Macklemore for 2 years. 2 years I'm telling you about Macklemore. Now look at this. So, you know, you have a lot more of a receptive ear, you know, towards what I'm bringing to the table by actually not listening. And then I'm able to go back and remember that in my brain and leverage that, you know, later on. And so if you have access to the back end of your Facebook, your Instagram, your YouTube, and all these things that you never had access to before, use that free data that's there. And, you know, your Facebook ads and things like that are really important on the spend wise, but also do what you need to do to make sure that you're directly contacting your fan base off of social media. If Facebook closed down or Instagram closed down, a lot of us are just fucked, right? Because we're communicating mostly to our fans from these social media platforms. And it's really important to get people's emails and phone numbers, their locations and birthdays or whatever, so you can communicate, you know, with them outside of, you know, of the social media. And a lot of people do email marketing. And again, me personally, I'm not big, I'm not clicking a lot of these email blasts that I'm getting. But text message marketing obviously is something that's picked up a lot. And it's more so the ability to directly have that communication with your fans, and vice versa. As a fan, I want to directly communicate with my favorite artists, or I use, you know, LeBron James as an example, because his Instagram, like, I know it's him that's posting. It's not, it might be his social media guy once in a while, but like, if it's like a selfie with him and his son and like, you know, all this stuff, and it's like, you know, it makes me feel closer and more part of what he's doing. And I know that, you know, at least as a fan for myself, that definitely drives my activity to consistently check that. Maybe I've never sent him a message or commented on any of his pictures, but I'm checking on them all the time just to kind of see like what he's doing. And as far as marketing your music, I think that, you know, there's a similar, you know, trajectory there. I would try to spend just as much time as you do on social media to make sure that you have your nest egg off of social media? Do you have 1,000 fans? Do you have every single one of their names, phone numbers, emails, and birthdays? Like, even if you just have that and they're all like Big Jerry, you're good. That's it. You don't need anything else at all. And you could just be free to create, and you know, you'll be happy and fine. Moving down, if I had $500 to promote a song, you know, how would I spend it? And I think for me, it would go back to what kind of assets I had for that song. If I had a video, like a music video, for example, for that song, or a visual for that song, I think an amazing spend, again, probably one of the better spends, is the, you know, is the YouTube ads, just because I like the notion of, I don't want to pay for some just impressions, right? I don't want to just pay for someone that sees it. I want to pay, you know, I feel okay to pay. I don't want to pay for anything, but I feel okay paying for something that, you know, that actually I can go back and see that is driving me results. And on the event side, for example, I know that a lot of artists are, you know, are spending money on, you know, advertising for shows. And the reason is because I can say, hey, I spent $200 on this ad and I sold $3,000 worth of tickets. Right? Like, you can literally see that. You can see the trajectory, you know, the kind of the correlation there. And I think that's an important, you know, piece. But if I only had $500, you know, to spend on a song, depending on what kind of assets I had, I think YouTube would be great. Of course, Facebook and Instagram ads are still really, really, you know, just successful. Even if you hate Facebook or Instagram, like, it doesn't really matter as much, because people are on there and you can target them, and you can do it in a way that's, you know, very specific and very successful as far as the return on your investment, how much you're spending versus how much you're getting back. And so most of it would be a digital spend, but I would also suggest and, you know, try to kind of tell everyone to keep in mind that once your song is out and it's a, you know, available everywhere, it's just born to the world. It's a baby. Okay. It's now going to be available forever, for infinity number of time. Right. And because of that, you can't just look at a campaign in such a short, like, window, and you have to try to imagine and understand that this $500 that you're spending is $500 for the entire life of this song. Like, you know, you probably are going to want to invest more resources into it. And again, letting the market dictate that for you. You might think a certain song is going to do a certain thing, but your fans and the market will tell you what it really is. Like, for us with Kali Loving Reggae, like, we knew that it was an amazing song. We, you know, Kali immediately was like, this is the one. And, you know, when we put it out, and even now, like, we're still just starting that campaign, right? Like, we're literally just seeing, like, you know, and it's been out for, I think, what, 2 years now. You know, we're just starting really, like, to get into that campaign. And you got to understand that it's a long, 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 long game. And let the market dictate and show you kind of what's doing well. And be mindful of the time of the year and who you're kind of marketing. And don't spend, you know, your blow your wad in the, you know, all in the beginning, as opposed to just, you know, consistently adding to it. And one thing that I'm really, as a fan, you know, I think would be cool, and this is something I, you know, I kind of clash with some of our artists, is I wish artists would release music videos for some of their older songs. I don't care if you have a new album out. I want a music video to Blind to You Haters. Like, I want a music video for, you know, for songs that I like. And I know that people would be receptive. You guys tell me how you think, but even if it's older songs that have been out for a really long period of time, like, if you don't have the ability to create a new song, or you're, you know, you're in a kind of creative zone that you're stuck, you can always go back and create more assets and new assets for your existing catalog to strengthen those. And, you know, I think that's something that I would love to see more, like, just songs that are my favorite songs from time, and all of a sudden they just have this really cool visual that, you know, that comes out today. I would, you know, I would be really excited about that. I saw a question here real quick about social media sponsorship here. I think it was from Mr. Lamar Brown. At some point, I think I saw that there. And I think, you know, depending on what that means, as far as social media sponsorship, like, there's so many ways to spend your money. And, like, I'm not big on, hey, let's pay all these influencers to, you know, to kind of go in and do all this stuff, as opposed to, you know, using that money to, you know, to potentially strengthen assets for your song. If you just have a song with, like, maybe a static background image, get a visual for it. Like, it doesn't have to be a music video. It could just be the background moving around a little bit. I think that, you know, paying somebody to do anything on my end, I'm always thinking about it like, you know, it's my money. So I think it's important to, you know, to be very, you know, strategic with how you're spending it. And social media sponsorship, you might as well get ads, right? You might as well spend money on ads. And I have seen a lot of success on ads. And I would, you know, continue and would suggest spending money specifically on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube ads, not as much on the Google side of things, but I would highly recommend everybody check out Vertical's agency in NEMA. If you're kind of more interested in and want to dive into that kind of more in depth. Let's see here. Going on down. All right, scrolling down. You guys had some great questions here. Let's see. One kind of thing in terms of videos that, you know, kind of going back to what we're talking about consistently within our own camp is how, if you have a video that's, you know, 27 minutes long, right, or however long it might be, try and you have limited resources, try and break that video up into smaller, more digestible, like, tidbits that you can promote from your Instagram and your social media, driving your traffic to your YouTube where you're monetizing, and, you know, have your full length video on that, right? So, for example, I know, you know, it was really cool to watch just now, Mike Love uploaded a new video to his YouTube page. And, you know, at first I was like, wait a minute, like, this is a 12-minute video, Mike, like, I don't know how this is gonna go. But, like, I ended up personally sitting there and watching this video over and over again, the full 12 minutes of it. And it kind of, you know, again, changed my mind a bit on, you know, on how and why and when to release longer videos versus shorter videos. And I think that if you're giving people snacks and appetizers and bits and pieces and using your social media appropriately, then, you know, you will get the people that are interested. They will watch it all the way through, right? But I'm a big fan of episodes, maybe because I'm, like, trained from watching, you know, Netflix and TV and stuff. And, like, I like to watch episodes of things that have, like, a beginning, a middle, and an end, and then I'm going to move on to the next thing. And I think that, you know, looking at kind of, like, you know, kind of for example, with the Keznambi album, there's so much footage and so much content that, you know, that we have that is the making of the project, the release of the project, even with the fact that it came out, you know, just now during the, like, the height of this, like, you know, coronavirus, documenting that and, you know, and putting that out as, you know, as part of content forever, as episodes, Road to Bloodline, you know, kind of the making of episode one, episode two, episode three, and each one of those things has, like, a main point, and you're able to take a lot of this footage that usually ends up sitting in purgatory on someone's hard drive, because a lot of it is similar style footage, and create a narrative for it. And that's something that Kez is really good at, is creating this narrative that makes it digestible for existing fans and for new fans to follow along and want to know, okay, like, oh man, like, you know, what happened with the release and how did it go and how did the coronavirus affect this? And so, you know, the phone that you have or the webcam that you have really is all that you need now to create that narrative for yourself, and to consistently be able to put that out there with very limited resources. A lot of people do spend, of course, a lot of money on this stuff, but you don't necessarily need to, as long as you can get creative with your visuals, with your narrative, and, like, you know, just use the tools that are there. And for me, maybe because I am relatively, I guess, new, so to speak, as opposed to, like, someone from the old industry, it's so much more obvious that, you know, with all these tools, it should be easier. Like, it's not like you can rely fully 100% on your analytics, but at the same time, like, you know, you're checking your website and you're getting 75% of your clicks from Seattle, right? Like, how could you ignore that information? You know what I'm saying? Like, it's, I'm not going to, when I'm talking to the promoter from Seattle, I'm not going to tell him I have 10 new music out, you know, music videos or albums. I'm going to say, listen, 75% of my traffic comes from Seattle, right? Like, give me a chance in Seattle. Let me, you know, let me get in there. Let me try and play. And we know that a lot of those people aren't necessarily going to come out, but proportionally speaking, data is data, and it does, you know, it does have a certain effect, and it, you know, it does work. There's a question here about photographers, and the, you know, the importance of photographers for, you know, for artists. And I think that, to me, photographers and videographers are essential pieces to an artist team. And the most, again, it's not a coincidence that the most successful artists and successful teams have, you know, amazing photographers, amazing videographers, and also, you know, kind of graphic designers and branding experts. But specifically on the photographer side, like, if you have a good photographer, or if you are a good photographer, then you will always be able to make yourself an integral part of, you know, of an artist team. And I would say it's, you know, it's just right up there with any other crew member that you need to have on the road with you, or even more so off the road, because a lot of times what happens is you have so much footage and you know, pictures of the performance and the show, and I love that, and that's great, but that's not what I want to see. I want to see what I can't see. I want to see what happens behind the scenes, behind the stage. I want to know, like, what's going on there. And the only way to be able to properly capture that is not just being a good photographer, it's also to have a certain, you know, to establish a certain comfort level with the artists that you're working with, to allow them to be comfortable and, you know, just act normally, so that way somebody could capture that, right? And I think, you know, there's definitely on our end, you know, we work with so many amazing, like, talented photographers that are able to do that. And that really does drive the brand. And I'm not going to say any specific names, but I've seen artists who, when they stepped up their image game, right, when they got the proper photographers and videographers kind of, you know, rolling with them, it changed the, like, the game for them. It noticeably, like, you know, increased their trajectory. And I think that if you are a photographer, or if you want a photo artist, or, you know, you want to kind of get involved, the best thing to do is to build up a, you know, a portfolio by hitting them up. Again, on social media, we get hit up all the time, and I check it. Like, it's one of the few things I check when I get hit up. It's like, yo, I would love, you know, I heard Collie Buds is coming to this festival. I want to come and, you know, shoot photos. And it might be for free for a certain period of time until you develop enough of a portfolio or enough of a relationship with an artist. But I also have no problem paying for those services, because I understand how important, you know, and vital they are, you know, to the success specifically of being able to maintain the activity of your fan, right? Like, the active kind of fan base. Yeah, so good. I mean, if you're a photographer, you know, I know a lot of times you guys get kind of the short end of the stick, and have to do a lot of work for free, but I would just try to, you know, keep your head low and kind of work through that, because if you can get comfortable enough with an artist and you could bring about a lot of the things that are not just on stage, because I'm at the show, I've seen the show, I've seen it, great, cool, I love it. And we do, you know, obviously we want that, but I want to, you know, I want to know what's happening behind the scenes. I want the jokes. I want the, you know, kind of like the, I want to feel like I'm a part of that. I want to feel like I'm there. And it's obviously not possible to bring everybody back there, even if we want to. But it is possible to capture that stuff. So I think, you know, huge respect and love to, you know, to the photographers that, you know, they're kind of driving the active fans for us. Well, I think, you know, one thing that I do, and I think a lot of managers do, just because it's a part of our job, is to constantly look around and see the, you know, the creative kind of things that other people are doing, and try and, you know, see what might fit my brand and what might work. And I think that, like, it's really about the combination of what is my artist comfortable with, right? Like, what I know what Kylie is comfortable with, or I think I know what he's comfortable with. And as a manager, I'm going to protect that comfort at all costs from others. But on my end, I'm going to push him a little bit, you know, outside of that comfort zone in a comfortable way, right? So I think like seeing especially how people are getting creative right now online with, you know, with a lot of these live streams and full shows. I know that, you know, I think it was Tropodelic that just, you know, I was blown away by their live stream. It was like a full on like production with lights and, you know, it was like, it was amazing. And, you know, good point on the Kali thing, like with Kali, you know, we've been looking at and watching a lot of these different things that are happening. And I think that, you know, now after seeing a lot of these, he's definitely a lot more comfortable in considering going live, and, you know, and doing a stream as well. One really cool creative thing that I've seen somebody do, and again, I'm not going to say who it was, but I seen an artist go live on their YouTube page like this. Okay. And they had like maybe, I don't know, a stack of 50 or 100 CDs. I don't know if they were, you know, older CDs or whatever they were, but he was live. And while live, he was literally saying, look, all these CDs are available right now. If you purchase them right now, I'm going to personalize them, sign them right now, and ship them out to you. So I watched as, you know, people were literally right then and there, just click and buy, click and buy, click and buy. And you know, I know CDs don't necessarily cost, you know, a huge amount, but if you don't sell them, who's really going out? I mean, there's CDs still do sell, believe it or not, but 50 or 60 or 80 CDs within, you know, a 30-minute time frame is impressive. And I thought it was a really creative way. And it just made me think about, you know, the social commerce side of things, to where as we're talking, as we're doing these things, are we spotlighting certain products, whether it's merchandise or whatever it is? You know, are we making it, are we personalizing those things? And some of the, you know, stuff that I've seen that I've really like enjoyed and have been like, you know, just impressed by are the ones that are doing that. And, you know, I think that it drives sales, but it also, again, going back to keeps your fan active, because now I might damn near already have the Kollywood CD, but if he's sitting there signing them live on, you know, on whatever YouTube or whatever it is, I'm going to get one probably. So that's definitely one of the cooler things I've seen. I see a lot of meet and greet stuff. One thing that I'm really personally into trying to figure out is a more efficient way for digital meet and greets, kind of like this. Cause you know, for company, you know, for our company, for Ineffable, we have, you know, people across the country. A lot of people that, you know, you email with, you talk on the phone with, and with all the stuff going on, we've been Zooming a lot more, which is similar to this, like kind of like a Google Hangout, to where we're all on the screen together. We can see each other's faces. We're talking to each other. We're interacting. I've really, you know, enjoyed that part, you know, kind of from what we're doing internally. And it just made me think about how do we, you know, kind of drive these digital meet and greets with, you know, with the fans and the artists. I know, again, Big Jerry's, you know, I see him on Instagram and Facebook all the time, or Facebook mostly, kind of, you know, doing these watch parties and inviting people to join him on Discord or Twitch or whatever it was. And I think as artists and teams, you know, we need to get better and more efficient at providing those types of opportunities for, you know, for our fans to, you know, to get together to talk to the artists, but also to talk to each other. Because that's really my favorite part about, again, like Buds Nation or Stick Family, is that it's, you know, Stick posts in there once in a while, or Kylie once in a while is like, yo, what's going on with Buds Nation? Like, what's the latest, you know, kind of what's the deal, and who's this person that know, you know, is transcribing all my lyrics and this and this. But the communication within, you know, the group is what's really cool. And that, again, that inner community drives, you know, more fans and just, you know, brings people a little bit closer together. So the digital meet and greets for sure are, you know, are something that hopefully, you know, we see a little just improvement on, just like we've seen on the live stream side. I would like a virtual Bloody Mary as well, please. Well, I mean, again, I can keep going here, never ending, conversation. And if, you know, if we weren't talking about this like this, promise you, I'd be sitting here in my bedroom, you know, having the same conversation on the phone, over and over, because, you know, it's just a part of this. So, I'm really glad that you guys stuck around for 2 hours of me rambling, which seems like I'm just talking to myself, because I'm just seeing myself and, you know, and seeing your guys' comments. But, you know, it's really cool. And I know that for myself personally, hopefully we can take a lot of the stuff that we know that works and help a lot of other artists that, you know, that are out there. We have a really cool team at Ineffable of, you know, of solid humans that are experts in what they do and what they talk about. And I think over the next coming, you know, couple weeks and even beyond that, you know, we're going to try to showcase some of them and have them kind of give you more in-depth insight about, you know, specific things you can do. Because I think this was just more of a general conversation, you know, and a general rant. But, you know, I think giving you specific tools and diving in more on some of this stuff is really necessary. And, you know, there's such a huge, I personally have zero artistic like capability. I, you know, unless I'm in the shower, like I can't sing or dance or any of that, but there's so much room within the music industry for music industry professionals, managers, and, you know, and so many other kind of like, roles that right now are left completely open that I encourage anybody that's interested or has been interested, not necessarily to leave your job or anything, but, you know, to start familiarizing yourself, making yourself available. And, you know, deep down inside, if, you know, if you're, you know, if you, if this is something for you. And absolutely huge shout out, of course, to Marina and Adam and Abel and everybody at Ineffable. I'm not going to start listing them because then I'll forget people and it'll be a whole thing. But without the team that we have, without specifically on the, you know, especially on the management side, like a lot of times I get the credit, right? I'm like, oh, cool, I've seen you with Kali Buds and, you know, your Kali's manager and this and that. True, but without the management team that we have, like most of the stuff would not be possible. It wouldn't be possible to manage multiple artists. Wouldn't be possible for all of us to specialize in every single thing. And so we're big on, it doesn't matter who, you know, who gets what, we all get a ring if we win, right? Like we all get a championship ring no matter what. So I think with our team, there's a lot of people behind the scenes that you don't ever see, or, you know, or kind of get a chance to interact with, but they are the glue, and the heartbeat behind, you know, making sure that a lot of this stuff works. And a big reason why we choose the artists that we choose is because they understand that and are super appreciative and treat those people like the rock stars, you know, that they are. And so I think, you know, it's just important to kind of acknowledge that and for you guys to know that, you know, I get to, you know, to do a lot of the cool stuff and take credit and get credit for it, but it's not just me. And I'm sure that, you know, that works the same for a lot of other teams and whatnot. So, you know, I miss more than anything going to the office and just, you know, being there and hearing, you know, Thomas yelling about this and someone else in here. And like, it's motivating to then, you know, get back to the office and start, you know, start working on stuff. And while that's happening, the artists are there in the studio making music. And, you know, again, it just bounces off of each other, and, you know, makes it a really cool and special, you know, kind of workplace. The Scrim Lords, I believe, are working on their merchandise. I don't know if they have anything out currently yet, but they do have an Instagram. So you can follow the Scrim Lords for merch if they have some. Abel and or Spencer and Ann and those guys. If anyone else has more questions or wants to continue babbling with me, then Reed maybe can you know pass on my email. Probably won't respond, but if you really are into it and you have some specific questions, now more than ever, I think we have some time to, you know, to kind of get into some of this stuff. And I love, as you can see, just never ending talk about anything music or whatever, negative or positive. You know, feel free to reach out to us. And, you know, most importantly, just, you know, thank you guys, thank Rootfire for supporting. And let's make sure that while this crazy corona thing is going on, that, you know, that we stick together. Please stop asking for refunds for shows, okay? Because, you know, if everyone's getting their refunds on these shows, it's just so impossible to reschedule them. And we're working hard to get a lot of that stuff rescheduled. I know, for example, with Cali Roots, you know, Dan and the Cali Roots team worked so hard on securing the full lineup. And that's, you know, that's just really amazing to see that so many artists with so many logistical hurdles were able to, you know, agree to, you know, to move the date. And so, you know, it's just really cool that collectively we're all coming together. It's unfortunate that it's during, you know, all this craziness that's going on. We don't know when it's going to end. But at least, again, we're home, healthy, happy, some of us. And, you know, it could be a lot worse. Okay. Any last minute, anything from anyone? If I missed your question somewhere up top, I'm sorry. And thank you guys. I'm sure we'll do this again very soon. All right. Maybe Adam, you could drop in the link for the new movement, Cali Roots Rhythm Song, which comes out on Friday. Please pre-save that and pre-save the whole project. And just when we're all done here, if we can all please go and listen to some music, stream some music that you don't normally listen to, because we do see that on the back end, especially on Spotify. Support an artist, listen to some of their stuff, buy some merch, everything.